Hello, my name is Frances. Welcome to the Wool Winder podcast, episode 6. This is my podcast where I talk about my knitting, the things I like to knit, what I finish, like this Tolsta Tee, what I've got on my needles at the moment and how that's going, what I'm casting on, and I've got a couple of cast-ons this episode to talk to you about, and what I'm hoping to cast on soon. So come and enjoy me, come and escape into the world of knitting. So welcome. If you're new, it's lovely to have you here. And if you've watched episodes before and you're coming back, hello again, it's so nice to see you. So we have got here, what I'm wearing is my Tolsta Tee. It's finally finished. We had a bit of fun towards the end as we got to the hem. I thought, let's do something different. Perhaps did a split hem and was going to do a folded split hem. So I did that, quite a lot of work involved in it. Tried it on and it just didn't hang right. So back to the drawing board. So I undid all that and I went back and went for a traditional 2x1 rib. So let me see, I'll stand up and show you the rib on there. I'll put a photo in as well so you can see it a bit more easily. So Tolsta Tee. When I cast on the Tolsta Tee, I cut out the rib section, should I say, and cut it out. Because I wanted to do the I-cord bind off at the end. So started without the rib, worked down, doing my increases. I would say, so this is knitted in this is the 4-ply version. It's knitted in the Summerlight, Rowan Summerlight 4-ply. It's quite unforgiving. I was a little bit worried in places where I felt the stitches were uneven and what have you. I've washed and blocked it. That's made such a difference. So I'm really pleased with how that's gone. So we came down. When we got down to here, I reduced 2 stitches either side just to pull it in slightly, just to give it a little bit of shaping. It's very subtle, because I knew that I'm larger around here than I am down here, so I just wanted to try and get that slightly better sort of shaping in it. So and then we came down as I say, I did the 2x1 rib, so it's not a split hem, it's just a straightforward traditional hem in the 2x1 rib. And then I came up and I did the I-cord bind off, so the sleeves have got an extra 3 centimeters added into them from where we left the sleeves on the holder. Added a 3 centimeters and then did an I-cord bind off, and then the same with the neck. And then, as I say, blocked it, left it to soak 15 minutes, rinsed it, blocked it out, it's very pleased. It feels really nice to where it's very drapey. Now it's interesting, you remember, you may, if you watch previous episodes, that I took the sizing on this. I looked at the actual measurements on the pattern and then looked at the actual measurements of a cotton linen tee that I've got, a shop bought one, which I felt was a really good fit, a really good size on me, both in terms of width and length. So I took those measurements. That's what this is based on. And this is actually, because it's drapier, it feels looser. Whereas I'd say perhaps the cotton linen is more, holds more to your body. This drapes, just sort of hangs off. So it gives a looser feel. But that's really nice. And I love the colour, and it feels really cool. yeah, it, you know, it doesn't feel at all warm, which, because it, I mean, it is cotton and it's a four ply, but yeah, no, so it's really nice. Right, so on to the Nachtschatten cardigan. So we have reached a milestone with this. Let me just hold up and show you that for you. I have finished now. So what we've got two sleeves, and that's the bit that runs around the back. And they've been finished off with the Latvian braid, which never done one before. Not difficult. You are essentially knitting one stitch blue, one stitch cream, one stitch blue, one stitch cream around the first row. Then the next row, you're bringing the yarns to the front and you're purling one stitch blue, one stitch cream, but you're twisting the yarn so you pick up the yarn from underneath each time so that they're twisting around. You end up with your yarns really twisted. It's like intarsia and gone really wrong. You know, it's very intensive intarsia, should I say, you know, where your yarns get all twisted. But then when you do the next row, you go back the opposite way and it unwinds. So right as you get towards the end of that row, you're thinking, the second row, you're thinking, you know, because it's getting very twisty, getting quite tricky to work with. And then you unwind and, yeah. And you end up with this lovely finish, which, yeah, I think it's really nice. I'm really pleased with that. So I've not done that before. So we've got this. This is the back. And you can see that. So if I pop this on to show you kind of how it worked. As I said in a previous episode, it's a little bit like a shrug at this stage. So there you go. It's just, yeah, it was beautiful. It's lovely yarn. So it's exquisite four ply by West Yorkshire Spinners with silk in it. So really nice yarn. So got the ends going on here. Right, so next stage is I'm going to be picking up the stitches from about here, I think it is, and round here, and all the way underneath, round the back, and round here to that point, and then you knit your cardigan down in the colour work. And yeah, that's going to be probably the more challenging part. So because it is colour work and it's in four ply, so challenging as in more than anything, I think, is that it's going to be a lot of work, going to be a lot to it, but it's will also equally, I think, be beautiful when it's finished. So yes, anyway, if I hold it up around that way, you can get an idea as your sleeves go in there. Yeah, so really, really lovely. It's really coming on really beautifully. So, okay, so I've finished the Tolsta Tee. So, been needs sort of thing what to cast on. So, I think I've got a bit of a contrast of two things going on here, actually, because Rowan have brought out a knit along with Martin Story. And I've kind of, over the years, because I've enjoyed knitting Rowan yarns for years and years, and over the years I've dipped in and out of these knit alongs. So they tend to do one most years, but I've only done maybe every 2 or 3 years. Anyway, so this year seemed like a one. In fact, actually, I'll show you. I'll pop in a picture. The last one I did was 2 years ago, I think. Yes, it must be 2 years ago. And it was knitted in Rowan's Island Blend, and I can't for the life of me think what the name of that knit along was called. Anyway, I knitted it. You'll see the picture of there. That's for my daughter, and she, for her to take to university. So it's looking a little bit more well loved now. So, but better well loved than not used. So, yeah. I decided they're doing a new one. They've just launched it, and it's called the Midwinter Blanket, and I think they call it their Rowan's Festive Knit Along. And they released the first square last week. So I've got started on my first square. Just, I think you can see. So it is knitted in Rowan's felted tweed. They're going to do a square, launch a square every week. I don't know that I will do the blanket this time because it's a big commitment and I'd like to knit other things to talk to you about. So what I want to do, I think I'm going to do is a, either way, it's going to be a cushion or a blanket, but I think it will be a cushion. It will go into my new studio room, and I'll talk to you a little bit more about that towards the end of the video. So the colours are kind of based on that. But it's a great excuse for me to use. This is one of my favourite things. Let me just bring it over. I have here, this is my box of Rowan, of felted tweed. So it's a Rowan yarn. I love this yarn. It is my favourite yarn. But in particular, it's great for knitting garments with, but it's also great for knitting bits and pieces with. It comes in so many lovely colours. But because it's felted, you see it's got that tweedy sort of effect to it. Whenever you put one colour with another colour, it just works. You know, it's almost difficult to not have colours, you know, work, you know. So it's, yeah. Oh, maybe those two don't work either. In this box is my, these are, most of them anyway, are ones, half-finished balls of different colours. And then the idea is whenever I'm dipping into a colour work project with a little bit of felted tweed, I can dip in, and choose these, and I've done all sorts of projects using the felted tweed. It's great fun, and it responds really well. Responds really well to blocking. It's great for using in like fairisle and that sort of colour works. You can see from the square. It's a little bit forgiving if your colour work's not perfect. I enjoy it. That's that. So my intention with the blanket is, as I say, I think I'll do the cushion. It 9 squares on one side it needs for the cushion. So I might just do the 9 squares and then do a stripy back, or we'll see. We'll see whether after I've done a number, whether I'm sort of starting to lose it. But I just started that, and you know, really enjoying it, and it's quite because it's small, it's a nice little project. Whereas now, as we're moving on to the satin cardigan, that's going to be, and I pick up the stitches and start doing the bit going down the back, it's going to become quite large, isn't it? So not a kind of easy project to sort of move about. So this is a nice small project for doing that with. So And, you know, sometimes when I've done these, I think what's really nice about the knit-alongs is, whether you're doing Rowan or anybody else's knit-alongs, is it can be an introduction. You know, if you've not done much colour work before, this is a good little place to start, you know. And if a square goes wrong, it's only a square, isn't it? You know, is a good place to test out, try out your colour work. So I've, talking about learning colour work, I've been knitting colour work for years, just using, literally picking up and dropping, and that's absolutely the best way to start. But as more recently, I wanted to do it two-handed, and I did a number. It was during the early part of COVID, when you couldn't do sort of one-to-one lessons. So I did a number of different online tutorials. And it was interesting because it was only when I got to a particular one, and I'll put her name on the notes. Just trying to remember her name now. And it was her course that really got me going two-handed, holding each yarn, one yarn in each hand. That's been really helpful. You then pick up. I felt that the way she did it just clicked with me. Once I started going, it was like, yes, this works. I've got other friends I know that have both yarns in one hand, and other people. I know somebody who knits really proficiently with colour work, and just picks up and drops. And yet, you know, she knits masses of most wonderful, complicated garments. So, you know, it's a question of finding what works for you, I think, really. So anyway, for me, that's what works, is having the yarn in both hands. That's great, obviously, when we're knitting. When we're on the wrong side of the work, as many English patterns do have a wrong side and not necessarily in the round, then that's a little bit harder purling. And that's been something that I've done courses and tried different ways of purling so that I can continue to hold the yarn in two hands. The only way that's worked for me so far is the Portuguese style, where the yarn that you hold in your left hand either goes through a brooch or around the neck, so somehow it's kind of held up here, which is a little bit fussy, and particularly if you're, you know, doing it out and about. But I have actually just recently picked up a ring, and I popped that on my thumb, still holding the yarn. So working on the wrong side, holding the yarn, the second yarn in my left hand, first yarn in my right hand, because I'm an English thrower style knitter. But the ring just holds the yarn in the right place for when I'm picking. Which is obviously what the way I'm working on the left hand side. So I'm constantly exploring new ways of knitting. Throwing is a slightly more intensive work. It's intensive on your muscles, and it's also slightly slower. So in an ideal way, I'd like to find something that was a little bit faster, but I think what I've learned is that I think it's two things. I think, first of all, it's got to be something that seems to feel intuitive or natural to you. But I think it's also got to be, you've got to practice it. It won't come immediately. And the more you practice, the more quickly it flows. And it's interesting because when I picked this back up, when I started this, I've not done any colour work for a long time. Immediately, yarns in both hands, and off I go without even thinking about it, you know. And I've only been knitting like that since early 2020, so, you know, not that long at all, really. But yeah, once you get to grips with it, once it sort of gets into your veins, then it's just one of those things, which of course is that muscle memory, isn't it? It's how we work with knitting, isn't it? So yeah. So that's that project. You probably remember that I bought some soy cotton. I talked about that on the last episode. I bought that Excuse me a moment. I bought that at the Summer Wool Festival that I went to recently. And I looked at different projects, and I was going to do the journey pattern, which is a lovely pattern, and I still want to do it. That's on hold till next year now. I'm kind of mindful of the fact that, so I couldn't find the right pattern that wasn't a really complicated pattern, going to take quite a while. And I'm thinking, well, hey, we've passed the midpoint in August now. We're kind of moving towards September, and I'm conscious of that, and my mind's going forwards to start my daughter going back to university term and all those kind of things that are coming along with autumn, you know, things like this. You'll notice I use the word festive. There's no way I'm using the C word in August. It has its place, and it's definitely not in August. So I thought, I keep coming across other podcasts where people have done the Ranunculus. Now, I know many of you will have done it, but there is clearly a real attraction to it. There is clearly, it's an unusual pattern. It's interesting. It's incredibly, it seems to be, from what people are saying, incredibly engaging. And I thought, do you know what? I'd really like to give that a go. And the other thing that was in its favour was it seems to be quite quick because it's knitted on larger needles. You know, when you think that I'm on 3 mil millimetre needles for the Nachtschatten, the Tolsta Tee was knitted on 3.5 mil, whereas this is knitted on 6 mil Tolsta Tee. So last night I got started. Let me just show you this bag as well. This came yesterday. It's from Hedgehog Creations. And it's got Highland cows on. And so, and I come from Scottish ancestry and, yeah, love Highland cows. It reminds me of visits back to Scotland. So, yeah, very pleased with that. Lovely little bag. So, here we are. This is how far I've got because I literally cast it on last night. And this, I know, amazingly, is the neck. So it's, you know, I keep looking and then I look at it and think, oh, it looks uneven. Anyway, let's stop, you know, we'll go a bit further before we cast any sort of, you know, the pattern is amazing in the sense that there is so much help in there, so many videos, lots of talking about sizing, lots of photos. So that's great. And in fact, to be honest, really, when I was looking at it last night, because I bought the pattern last night, it was like, oh, this is almost a bit overwhelming. There is so much there. And I was trying to rush. So I'll need to spend more time looking at it. Got cast on, got started. I had spent some time looking at my size. It needs a lot of positive ease. So you remember I was saying about the Tolsta Tee and how this is so much more drapey than a cotton linen t-shirt of the same measurements, and yet this sort of drapes and it looks like, and I think that's because it's the garments are knitted on larger needles and the Ranunculus seems to be the same, working the same way. So it's very drapey. And with the Ranunculus, you're supposed to have, I think it's about 18 inches positive ease, which just seems bad, doesn't it? You know, especially if you're small, you know. But anyway, I have done it with that level of ease. Although when you cast on, actually I'm talking about sizing, but actually when you cast on, everybody casts on with the same amount of stitches. And it's not until you get to beyond the yoke that you... I think I'm right in saying that, that you actually make the adjustments for your size. So that'll be interesting. Anyway, I have decided on my size because, you know, that is obviously an important part. So this, I have started, there's a number of cast-ons that Midori, the designer, suggests, or she gives you some choices. This is the crochet chain provisional cast on. which is a slightly more tighter neck than the other one. But I can see from picture what I've seen about other people, the other neck is quite loose. I didn't want to go, you know, that, whilst I don't want it sitting really tight around my neck, I don't want it too loose either. So, so you can see you've got the provisional cast on, not the same as, do you remember I did the provisional cast on for the Nachtschatten cardigan, where we did a crochet chain and then just knitted into the loops. This is different. As I say, there are lots of videos and things talking you through it. If you're a fairly new knitter, not very confident knitter, I also came across Sundragon. I can't remember. I'm pretty sure she's in the States. But I can't remember whereabouts she is in America. But anyway, she's done some great videos and literally walking you through it hand by hand, helping you choose your cast on, showing you how to do the cast, all sorts of things. So if you're not very confident, but you'd like to give it a go, I really recommend looking her up. You know, they look to be really, just really helpful. It's just somebody to hold your hand, you know, if you feel that that could be useful. I'm going to dive into this, and I hope next time that I can talk to you a little bit more and maybe understand a bit more about what all the excitement is and why everybody, they don't just knit one, but they knit several. So, that's interesting. So watch this space. I'm back in my Highland Cow bag. Makes me think when we stayed up in Scotland, in Drumadochy, they had, which is by Loch Ness, they had a baby calf Highland cow. I've never seen one that young before. And it was in the field just outside the dining area of our bed and breakfast. Oh, it was just so cute. But everybody was stopping to take photos of it. He was there with his mum, and he was, you know, not much bigger than a dog, really. Obviously chunkier, but, you know. It was just so cute, and everybody was taking all these photos of him. He was just lovely. It was just reminding me of that, looking at that. So, where are we? What are we going on to next? Right, so now I thought we'd now move on to the next section, where we're reviving old projects, old works in progress that are nearly finished but not quite finished. And I'm thinking that I need to have think of a better title for it, don't I? So anyway, yeah, put that one on the back burner and see if we can come up with a nicer name for it. Anyway, so what we're looking at today, we are looking at Pale. This is, so let me just start off showing you. Here we go. So it's an Intarsia project. It's called Pale. It's from Mode 6, which was like a yellow and white sort of themed summer magazine from last year. I am, like many of my projects, nearly there. So nearly there, but not quite. So here we are. We have a sleeve yet to go on. And then it has got the front band is knitted, then you do a line of garter stitch, and then you go back and knit it, and then you fold it. So it's the front band. What I'm trying to say is the front band is folded. And I've started even stitching that along. In fact, there was a needle attached to that until recently, so that must have fallen down somewhere. So that's what I've got to do. I've got to sew down the hem, put on the sleeve, and then, so it's an Intarsia project. I've got a lot of ends to sew in, but so nearly there. And for one reason or another, this got put down because I remember working on it really hard on our holiday in Suffolk last summer, which would have been late August. And I think I got to a point with it, and then we hit the autumn and I moved on to autumn and winter knitting, and this got put to one side and then not picked up again. So I think this time I need to do it. So it's knitted in summer light, and I'm pretty sure it's summer light 4-ply and kid silk haze. So that makes a really nice feeling fabric. I really like it. It's quite sort of luxury sort of feeling. So I think this jacket will be really nice. So it's quite a statement piece, isn't it? So, and the intarsia on it was quite challenging. It's at the corners. It's making sure that stitch is the same size as the other stitches, so that you don't, so that it looks square. It's lovely, and it's definitely worth getting out and finishing, you know. So there are some projects in that pile that I had at the beginning. You probably remember me saying that there were a number, one of the things that inspired me to start doing the podcast was that I had a number of unfinished works, and I wanted to bring out my unfinished works and get them finished. But of course, as we all do as knitters, of course, I am still making sure I'm doing that. But of course, there's all these other things that you see that you want to do and you want to share, and you get sort of carried along with that side of it. So, yeah. Oh, actually, the sun's gone in and I'm almost feeling like I could put this on. What else have we got? So that's all my knitting news for the moment. There was plenty of that. So on to future knitting plans. And you may remember that I ordered some yarn that I didn't have at the time when I spoke on my last episode from the wool festival, the summer wool festival. That has now arrived, all beautifully wrapped up. And it's from Blue Fern Yarns. It is a 4-ply yak. And this colour is called Happiness. And their 4-ply yak is 70% superwash merino, 20% yak, 10% nylon. And I've got 1200 metres with this. And it feels lovely. And it's got that kind of fleck through it that you get with yak, which I really like. I think it gives a real interest. And what I want to knit with this is a cropped cardigan. I have a lovely yellow raglan sleeved cropped cardigan that I wear such a lot. A nice shop bought one, but it has been worn and worn. And so I thought it would be nice to have a new one. And this time I'm going to knit it. I've searched for patterns, and I found double knit patterns that are just what I'm looking for, but I don't want to start doing the maps and playing around with it. I'd rather do it properly. So I have found now two four ply fingering weight patterns that I'm considering toying between the two of them. So they are ochre from Amber O'Brien, and Felicia by Atelier Emily. Not quite, they're both beautiful patterns. Not quite sure which way I'm going to wait. Both of them are, there's a lot of stocking stitch involved, and the idea of that is it's a light release in comparison to the satin cardigan, to the colour work that I'm doing on the next satin cardigan. Obviously, on top of that, I've also got the festive knit along, the squares of the festive knit along, and I've got the ranunculus as well. So I think between them there'll be some concentrating and some nice relaxed knitting, and yeah, we should actually. So I'm not sure when I'm going to cast this on. Probably see it depend on how I'm going along with the others. because this is more of a knit that doesn't have, well, I'd like it to be ready in that in-betweeny kind of time when we're kind of wanting a cardigan, but not, but it's not so cold you want big jumpers on, because I've got plenty of plans for when we get to the big jumpers as well. So, right, well, that is all my knitting. I forgot to say, if Shannon at Blue Fern Yarns, because it is a little small independent dyer, she'd put in some little bits and pieces in their tiny Yorkshire tea bag. I love Yorkshire tea. That is my favourite basic brand. And biscuit. There's a little sachet of coffee in there, and some information about the yarn. So that was a lovely touch. Going on from non-knitting, well, I guess slight knitting news, I've got a studio so we have a room in the front of our house that used to be a room used by the children. And now that there are no children at home full time, we've decided to repurpose it. So the idea is, at some point, being in England, filming in the garden is not going to be an option. That studio will hopefully make a nicer place to film than the filming in my main room. So I'll show you that in a minute. It's a work in progress, but I'll show you a little bit of footage from that in a moment. I've also got some footage of a walk. My daughter and I, she's home from university at the moment, getting up to out for lots of lovely walks and stopping in pubs for lunch and various things. And then we also last week went along to Alison, who I run the Wool Winder workshops and escape days with. Her day job, she works as a costumier in a company that supply the costumes for film, stage productions and TV productions. And really interesting jobs, you can imagine. And they are based in North London, and I'll put a link down on there, because I'm pretty sure that anybody can book tours there. But we went on a tour with Alison to look round inside their warehouse and see the things they have. It's the most enormous warehouse. They have got so many costumes there. They've been going for about a century and a half. So there's that wonderful history. And you're really struck by the creativity that when you're making a film or stage production or what have you, in order to portray the story that you're telling, of course, the costume is really important. You know, it's that visual, isn't it? And indeed, when they very first started up, one of what they used to be doing was hiring costumes to people that were going for auditions, because if you had the right costume in an audition, you were expected to provide your own, then you were much more likely to get the part than somebody that might actually be a better actor but didn't have costume. Costumes were such an important thing. And oh my goodness, the costumes they have, and the uniforms, and they have costumes from, they have, you know, period drama things, going back several centuries. And then they have the decades from the 20th century, like the 1930s, the 1940s, 1920s, of course, 1960s, 70s, so forth, all that kind of thing. They provide costumes for so many massive films, and in fact some of them are so massive that they can't hire out the costumes afterwards again because they're just completely iconic. So it was really interesting, really interesting. And also, where they haven't got the right costume, then they make it, or they might have an original piece which they don't want to use for a production, but they will then make in their workrooms a reproduction of that And they've got reproductions of even things like the dresses Queen wore and that kind of thing. So, yeah, lovely, really, really interesting place to go. That was really fun. So it just leaves me to say thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed it. And if you did, please think about subscribing. And I hope that we'll see you back on the next episode. But until then, enjoy your knitting, take care, and if you want to stay around and watch the last little bit of footage that I've got at the end. Okay, bye-bye. And here is my studio, very much a work in progress. This is the before shot, if you like, but it's a nice square room looking out over the front garden, and probably do my filming, I think, over here, and then we're planning on having knit alongs, knit nights, knitting lessons in the room as well.